We're all set.
Why is this not working? Oh, that's on. This is on.
No, it's on.
It is on?
It's just blue.
It wasn't working earlier for a class I was in before.
Medical step here. But so, what did you read? More Descartes or Hobbes, Leviathan, or what? What have you been reading for today?
I always just read the full thing on the Internet Encyclopedia of Philosophy because I can understand it easily.
The Stanford Encyclopedia?
No, not that one. That one's confusing.
It's just
called Internet Encyclopedia of Philosophy.
Oh, I thought that was the Stanford one. But maybe not.
Different. Yeah, it's different.
Yeah, the Stanford one is very hard to get.
Hard to understand. Well, this didn't talk about Hobbes' theory of knowledge, which is one of the essay questions. I didn't talk about that at all.
I don't know why it's not behaving.
Didn't I have a guild?
He just got married. Completely off. Sorry, it's taking me a minute here. But since we have a class in here before we come in, and they're always hanging around, this is apparently a good class or hard.
It's
either
math,
one.
So.
Okay, appears to be working now. So, trying to think, first thing I was going to do is put up some comparison dates here. So it's Galileo Galilei. So his brother was Michelangelo, but not the Michelangelo the artist. So that's kind of interesting. Hobbes. And I've seen different spellings of Hobbes, but this is generally the correct one that we take. By the way, Malmesbury elects a Hobbes of the Year is like you know, which is like the reigning town philosopher or something for the year. They also have a Hobbes club that you can be a member of. But the main reason to be a member is because they have two events each year. One is in November, where they have a Hobbes dinner, where everyone comes to one of the main hotels right there in town, and they have a big dinner and a speaker, who's usually one of the top philosophers in England at the time, and he gives us a talk, a 20-minute talk or something on Hobbes, and then they probably get drunk, something of that sort. And then the other event is in like the spring, and it's like some sort of a Hobbes festival where they have music and, you know, all kinds of. So if you ever get to Malmesbury, which is like somewhere in England near the Cotswold, I am convinced that J.R.R. Tolkien had Hobbes and his fellow Malmesbury people in mind when he came up with The Hobbit.
Really?
If you look at the countryside, it's like all the, you know, gardens, like the abbey where Hobbes went to school in Malmesbury, his first school. Today it's like the abbey house where you could go as, I guess you could stay there as a like a hotel kind of thing. But the main thing is the gardens. They have gardens all around. You can get totally lost in the gardens. Including they have like pyramid-shaped bushes, and all sorts of tulips and flowers and things, and little benches here and there. And every once in a while, you see this statue of a monk with a hood, or just, you know, it looks almost like Voldemort. You know, mm-hmm. You know, that's kind of a weird little the garden and everything. But it gives you the sense that they were Saxons. So and in fact, the abbey is on a hill that was referred to as the Iron Hill. This is not behaving. So we might have to live without it for today.
What did they keep here to do?
Tell them after class. So I'll just forget about this. Or she's gonna. So, yeah. Just, I don't know if that's true at all, but it just seems to me like the people around there are kind of like hobbits. And if you look at their houses, they don't have round doors and they're not underground, but pretty darn close. You know, they're clearly made out of the rocks from the neighborhood and you know, the little cootie holes kind of thing. So it just feels Hobbes-y, you know, hobbits. I don't know, Hobbes, hobbits. I'm just making this up, you know, as I go here, you know. But so that's kind of cool. But he grew up there, went to the school there, left there and went to Magdalen College, which is kind of interesting too, because that was where C.S. Lewis taught for like 20 or 30 years later on. So that's kind of interesting. Wasn't like the best student there was, because he liked doing his own thing, you know, that kind of thing. But he did get his BA or whatever the heck the degree was. And then the teacher who liked him assigned him basically to be the tutor for a young man who was William Cavendish, who was like in line to be an earl. So, you know, if we could pull up a screen, you can see, you know, he was the earl of, I don't think it was Shaftesbury, but something. Earl Shaftesbury, Cavendish.
That sounds really familiar.
Yeah.
What's his name?
Actually, I think Shaftesbury was associated with Locke.
Okay.
Yeah, so I don't know what the nobility association was there, but Cavendish, it was near Malmesbury, so it was their, that local area. And what that job meant was that he's, so Hobbes is about 20, and William Cavendish was probably not much younger than that, but Hobbes's job as his tutor was to take him on a tour of Europe.
That's really awesome.
Pretty awesome.
Also, so he was the Earl of Devonshire.
Devonshire, thank you. Thanks. You guys got it. Yeah, that's great. So, and when was Hobbes's birthday? It's
1552.
52. Oh, I should remember.
Oh, no, sorry. That's the Earl of Cavendish.
1588. Yeah. 88.
Is that wrong? He's older than the two. So, oh, that was the father. Okay, 1588. That's right. I guess, and he dies in
79.
So he's age 91.
Oh, wow. That doesn't seem right.
And he's famous for the line that life is nasty, poor, brutal, and short.
Mm-hmm.
Which is hilarious because his life is actually totally the opposite of all of that, you know? So that's funny. When's Galileo's birthday, though?
1564.
And he dies?
1642.
And he's pretty old, too.
77.
But at one of the trips, not the first one, but one of the trips when Hobbes is older, I think he is almost like in his 50s. Is it possible that they overlap like that? Maybe. Hobbes visits Galileo. So there's an actual physical connection in the two of them meeting, besides Hobbes obviously reading Galileo's stuff and things like that. And when we think of Hobbes, the impact Galileo had on Hobbes was physics, right? Motion, all these things of motion, you know, and how he's measuring all this stuff, which confuses me because Sir Isaac Newton does this too. Somewhere along the way, Newton is the one that's like supposed to have invented gravity, which we now know doesn't actually exist. So that's kind of cool. You know, all the things that Newton is famous for, well, they were famous for a while, but now we don't really accept them. Like the Euclidean universe, we don't accept that anymore. It's instead a relative universe. Gravity, you know, we no longer think of gravity as like, you know, Newton couldn't explain it. How does the sun keep the Earth in orbit, right? Gravity. You know, why do we stay on the Earth? Gravity. And by the way, gravitas is Latin for heavy. Right, so it's the heaviness. Why is it so? It's the heaviness. Okay. So that's not really an explanation. Now we know, it's really weird, but if you think, okay, so the Earth is traveling, what, at 2,500 miles per hour in a spin, right? Right? We're kind of going to the east. In fact, when I stand on the back deck of my house, I know that north is that way, and I look this way, and I figure I'm kind of sailing. I think of my house as kind of like a ship. Well, my solarium is kind of like one part of my ship, and I'm standing on the deck going that way, so I can see the stars are coming like this. So when the Pleiades are supposed to be falling, I look up, really more up this way, right? Because that's where, as we're moving, that's where, you know, those meteor showers, right? So they come into us that way, right? So that's where you can see most of them. You can see some over here, too, because, of course, where do they actually hit, you know, the atmosphere? So I'm thinking of myself as moving this way. So You don't really feel, it's not like a ship, you know, thank goodness, that make me puke, right? But, you know, here we go, that direction. And it's pretty weird, because of course, since we're traveling that way, what makes everything is the curvature of space. Everything's traveling in a straight line, but space is curved, says Einstein. And so the Earth is going in this direction, and I'm going in this direction too, but I'm curved more down than the Earth. So that's what keeps me basically right. Right, so I'm kind of like surfing. Right, this isn't really good for us to think of it this way when we're out walking, because that would be, you know, a lot more, you know, we don't have to think all that way. You know, we could say, Earth is still, and I'm walking on it. That works fine, right? It's wrong from this other perspective. Right? It's not that it's wrong, it's just a different model, right? And so if I'm driving, and I'm driving along, and the Earth is traveling at, so the car is actually going 2,500 miles an hour still. Right? If it's parked, it's still traveling, right? Right? But if I'm driving, say I'm driving to the east, I'm actually going faster than the Earth. If I'm going west, I'm slowing down. Get it?
Yeah, Pop was once on a plane where he was flying away from the sun, I think, so it took a really long time. I know, he was flying towards it, so it took a really long time to set, because they were chasing the sun.
Right. So it's not really gravity, it's that we're moving too, and the movement that we're following is like a gradual collision course with the Earth, so that we're on it. We're not just suddenly going. Does that make sense? That's weird to think about, right? But so Galileo is working on all these physical rules, you know, dropping the balls, various sized balls. Maybe it was the Tower of Pisa. I don't know. That was a fake story that they made up, or if he really did do the test, but where, right? But apparently he dropped the balls of various sizes. Aristotle oddly says that because they're all different weights, they'll fall at a different speed. And Galileo easily proves that that's false. I mean, it can be confusing when you've got like a sheet, because that does this sort of thing. Feathers, obviously not. People, you know, same speed as a ball, right? Splat! Oh, that's the same. Yeah. Sorry.
It's just funny.
Don't stand near that one end of the Captain Cook Hotel, because that's the favorite place for some reason where people jump off the 16th floor.
Do you know how many people have done that before?
At least one colleague's son, so I don't know, but I know that's occasionally in the news. They've tried to figure out how to fix that spot so that people can't get to that, but apparently it doesn't work.
Can I like just put a big net or like a trampoline?
Or you know, a circle with a person jumping with a line through it, you know? No, I'm not allowed to do that.
If you outlaw it, it will obviously go away.
Plus the from what I understand, right below is where the chefs all hang out on their breaks smoking.
That's awful.
Yeah, you wouldn't want your chef cooking your dinner who's a smoker. Sorry. I am weird, I know. Okay, so they met, and it's the physics of Galileo that's what makes him fascinating. He's not really into theology, even though they say he studies theology. You know, he's not, you know, in other senses really a philosopher. He doesn't do ethics. You know, he's not necessarily into logic, as far as I know. He makes lots of gadgets that can measure things, you know, like weights and stuff. A pump, you know, that you can help exit the water so that a ship can be, you know, fixed. You know, there are a lot of interesting things. The telescope, of course, that he improved after he stole the idea.
Would you say he was like also more so than a philosopher? He was like, you said like 20 seconds ago.
Scientist? Physicist?
A physicist, I think.
They didn't have the name for that. You know, William James points out that, you know, philosophy is, it's everything. But as you go through the course of history, like psychology becomes its own science and then suddenly becomes separate from philosophers still are all thinking about psychology because that's part of the big picture. But psychology now, you could actually go get a degree in psychology. In fact, there's like 250 different aspects of neuroscience that are separate today. 250 different things that you could get your degree in neuroscience in. And some of those folks that are both doing neuroscience but doing different aspects of it can't even talk to one another because their vocabularies are different. It's crazy, right? But it's all still philosophy. The same thing with astronomy. That was all part of all these sciences were and still are part of philosophy. But when you go back in time, there wasn't a separate science for it. But then as it became more and more stuff to study and more to know, they kind of separated their ways, and you get weird people like Stephen Hawking saying at the end of A Brief History of Time that philosophy is dead, your science should just take over. That's just dumb, because he's writing a philosophy book.
I just downloaded that as an audiobook.
Brief History of Time?
Yeah. Well, A Briefer History of Time.
Oh.
So
well, that's interesting.
Yeah.
I haven't seen that one.
It's like the revised version.
The brief one was already brief enough, actually.
Well, yeah.
But, you know, that's okay. The new one that I keep referring to is The Grand Design. That's the one he co-authored with Mladenov. And I'm not surprised because, you know, Stephen Hawking just sits there in the chair going, you know, that's hard to write when that's, I don't know how his computer does stuff. I want one, you know, so that I can just sit there in the chair and go, I've got a book, yay. Okay, so now Descartes. We have to study Descartes before we die. We have to put Descartes before de Hirst. That's totally wrong. But when is he born? It's nice and easy. He's like 1650 and 15. What? Anybody got it?
Oh, he was born 1596.
Yeah.
96?
Died
1650. So he's the youngest, mm-hmm. and dies the first. Obviously Galileo dies earlier. And he's influenced by Galileo also. In fact, his first book was The Traits du Monde. M-O-N-D-E. Francais est horrible. Did I say that right? My French is horrible. So, even though I studied it more than any of the others, but French is just...
More than Russian?
Well, Russian I learned in 1 year in an immersion course at DLI, and then spent 16 years, 9 months, and 3 days being... Well, that was my whole career.
But you spent more time learning French?
Well, French I had 2 years in high school.
Uh-huh.
Then I had three semesters of it in college. And I kept it up because I had to pass my graduate test in French to get my MA. So it makes sense. So, plus I read French. I have no trouble reading French. But then when they speak, I'm...
Can you write it down, please?
S'il vous plaît. Écrivez le mot. See, it takes, I have to penser long time. Like, you know, so it's not Huistre. Huistre is Russian, sorry. If I try to do something in a foreign language, Russian comes first. So that's pretty weird, I suppose. But Huistro, right, is a Europeanism. Is it Italian? French?
Because
the Russians picked it up and ended up with bistro, which is just a fast Russian way to say bistro, which means fast.
The origins of it.
Okay. So meanwhile, I'm thinking about these interrelationships here. Hobbes visits Europe, as far as I know, 4 times. Three separate visits with a tutor, different ones. Most of them all in the same Cavendish family, but one of them was like William Crofton or something, some other one. Oh, and meanwhile, he also tutors Charles II in France. Charles I, we all know, decapitated thanks to absolutely insane trial where the parliament says that he was a traitor, and he's like, I'm the king, how can I be a traitor to my, But he did come up with an army to fight the parliament's army because they weren't paying attention to him. And as far as the parliament was concerned, that was an act of a traitorous act. And so they put him on trial, which was illegal, but they found him guilty and they sliced his head off. Not with Madame Guillotine, because they didn't have that at the time. That was the French invention. But they have people with really big axes and stuff. The tower.
They were well prepared.
Apparently. But Charles II is automatically king, but since he's in France, that's an interesting problem. By the way, Hobbes, one of his books is The Leviathan, which is the one, was not his earliest one. His earliest one was De Cive, which is the citizen, or the state, the republic, really. Same as Plato, if you remember. Res publica, the public thing, which is Latin, not Greek. So why didn't he call it the Republic? I don't know. But the Cive, or I thought it was the citizen. Civis Romanus is Roman citizen. It was one of the books that I had to read in, because I had Latin first. But so in the Leviathan, we get this political theory, which seems to be the first place that we get it as a political theory of the legitimacy of the state and where the state comes from. And it's just this is my own little slapstick put together of where this comes from. We have Martin Luther. As you recall, he nailed his 94, 5 theses on the door. Ends up, that was supposed to be like discussion topics, you know, for the year or something. And instead, you know, somebody took it down and copied it and sent it all over the place. And before you know it, he was in trouble. And, you know, they looked at all of his other writings, and some of them were absolutely hilarious, but you're not supposed to be hilarious if you're a theologian. So, you know, they insisted that he recant all this stuff. He said, well, I can't recant, sorry, because a lot of the stuff is true. You know, I can't recant that. You know, a lot of the stuff, you know, it's just his whole argument, you know, he can't recant. So they basically kick him. They want to kill him, actually, but fortunately he has some German princes, one especially, that protects him, keeps him from being killed by the emperor. So that's kind of cool, but it also creates the 30 Years' War. And, you know, the famous Martin Luther dicta, kill them all and let God sort them out. It's too hard to figure out whether they really are with me or, you know, I don't know what, you know, because you could lie, you know. Who, like when Donald Trump invited the FBI head into the office and said, who'd you vote for? He said, I didn't vote. Good answer. It could have been a lie, though. How could you tell? You know, I don't know. Because even if you do vote, you don't have to vote for every candidate in the thing. So who knows? But do we want the head of the FBI lying to the president? Wow, that's pretty. But would that have been wrong? Everyone's kind of appalled that he asked them that.
Sorry.
Just
yeah,
kind of a fundamental principle of the democracy.
Yeah, that's kind of a weird position as the FBI guy. Like, that's awkward.
Yeah, yeah.
That's like your parents asking you, like, who's your favorite parent or something. It's like...
Yeah. Excellent analogy. Wonderful. I can't do that now because my parents are dead. That would have been fun to pull out. You guys are in running for best parent. I'll give you a week. See what you come up with.
Isn't that what he does in Calvin and Hobbes? Calvin gets out the like chart of his dad's like quarterly report.
But good point, by the way. Calvin is not John Calvin, who was Martin Luther's co-conspirator, the Calvinist,
mm-hmm.
and both Augustinians, which is interesting. And Hobbes, of course, is, you know, we can make the connection with Hobbes. Although I wouldn't call Hobbes a Calvinist, nor did he have a pet tiger. Bouncy, bouncy, bouncy. Okay. Wonderful things about tigers are I'm the only one. Right.
Wrong tiger.
That's the wrong tiger, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
tiger.
Oh, that's Tigger from Pooh.
Yeah.
See, I'm so confused.
I don't think
this
was
no.
bouncy. Or
that's right.
He was more contemplative.
But the comic artist says no, they have nothing to do with these two quotes.
Yeah.
That
would have
been cool if they did though.
So if you thought that everybody does, but no, there was no apparent intention. You try to read the comic and think, you know, how is that like, you know. But so Martin Luther ends up separating, we call this a sect, a Lutheran sect, that breaks away from Mother Church, and says that each individual should read the Bible for themselves. And then he makes that possible by creating a German translation. Thanks to the printing press, it's all over the place, and the church can't stop it. It's just, you know, plus all his books, they're all printed. And, you know, so the church, burn them! And there's like 50 of them going over that way, you know, you can't get rid of them. It's like Facebook, you know. Facebook didn't intend to make it possible for a TV celebrity to get elected president, but it made it happen, right? So, you know, you have these inventions and you have no clue what the results of these weird new inventions are going to be. But so, he influences Calvin, who starts his own
society in Switzerland, the Calvinists, and that's another church, and that includes John Knox, who, oh my goodness, talk about a horrible person. If you read some of his stuff, he absolutely was furious that Scotland had a queen. He was horrified that a woman would be ruling anything, right? But so Knox heads to Scotland, where he's from, and starts what we refer to as the and so the presbyters are like the rulers of the individual local churches. They vote. It's like a board. They have like a board meeting. And they decide who's the minister. And if they don't like you, they kick you out. So this is totally different. You know, in the Catholic Church, for example, if, you know, the priest dies or they find out that he's messing with little boys or something, the bishop will say, oh, got to move you somewhere else. Over here. Get different boys over here. I don't know. I'm sorry. That's horrible.
It's true.
But so the people in the parish have nothing to do with it. They're like, oh, I thought we had Father so-and-so. Now we've got Father Taylor. Well, how did that happen? You know, we got moved. Oh, okay. But if you're a Presbyterian, you guys spend time analyzing who the possible new minister will be, voting, you know, they sign a contract, they come in, and they're used to the idea that they're going to be lucky if they get like 2 to 5 years before you get disgusted with them and send them off and get somebody new, right? Because that's, you vote on who you want to listen to each week for there. And so this works out so successfully in Scotland that they decide, let's transfer that system to the municipal government. So Scotland, so if I had a device here, I could show you a neat book called How Scotland Invented the Modern World. What it's all about is, you know, so the Scots basically take this Presbyterian idea of we, the people, rule our church, and we, the people, rule our government, and of course that influences Edinburgh, the university, and that then influences England. And so if you kind of follow this idea, it's kind of like a virus, instead of God telling the Pope, who tells the king, who tells the dukes, who tells the earls, who tells the barons, who tells the knights, who tells, you know, instead of this great chain top down, there's no way you can like say, but sir, that's not going to work. But this is the bottom up. So this is like the total, you know, what do you want to call it, a total change in worldview. What makes a government legitimate is not the divine right of kings, so we say, but instead the will of the people. Whoa, so that's where this comes from. There's other things too. You could look at how the Magna Carta, right? Remember this, so this is earlier, right? So Richard, the Lionheart, keeps leaving, comes back just to get more money so that he could buy more men so that he could take them because he wants to go fight Saladin, etc. The one time he comes back, he gets kidnapped in Austria, and the Austrians insist on a bribe to release him. And so all the Jews in England all come up with a funding, send a check, which was like, hey, how do you get all this money to Austria to pay? So they send a check to their fellows in Austria, who then pay the and release him, and he comes back. And to thank them, he has a Holocaust in England and kills all the Jews. But he could. That happened. It really happened. Yeah. Thanks. We'll remember this next time. No. Yes.
Not to like cut you off, but like one of the essay questions is about like Descartes and Hobbes in terms of like current neuroscience, like which one would be more compatible. So could you kind of like talk about the two as far as that goes a little bit?
Right. Well, so Hobbes, in one of his criticisms of the Meditations, basically argues that Descartes is being silly because, right, he says, I can prove because of my cogito that I think, therefore, I am. But the I am is a res cogitans, a thinking thing. Can't prove that it's my body. Right? Because all that I know for sure is that I'm thinking. Hobbes says this is dumb because he's taking Galileo's physics, applying it to psychology, which says that we're all like a machine, a physical machine. So everything that happens is movements. So he's really fascinated with pressure, how I can touch something. Silly stuff, he thought that there was like air in the tubes in the body, and that they're, because the guy that invents the circulation of the blood, he's a friend of Hobbes, but he hasn't invented that yet. And so Hobbes thinks that it's empty tubes, because when you, I guess, dissect somebody after they're dead, because it's hard to do that while they're alive, that you find all these empty tubes, and he thinks that they're full of air, and that so when I push on something, it's like an air pressure that has, so that's kind of how I sense things. That's in Leviathan, as he's trying to figure out the methods of sense. The funnest one is when you see something, he comes up with the idea that particles from the object that you're seeing must stream into your eye. And that's how you see the object. And when I first read that, I thought, boy, that's stupid. Can you imagine little bits and pieces of the object streaming into your eye? But guess what? Actually, photons are exactly, in a sense, doing that, right? They're not particles of the object, but they're like bouncing off of the object. So actually, he's on track on all these things, except it's like so early yet, but you know, it sounds really weird the way he describes it, right? But your thoughts too. When I hear something, vibrations go into my head and they don't stop. They keep bouncing around in my body. Galileo tells us, unless there's like a, what, did he figure out that you need like something to slow something down? Because otherwise it will keep, or was that Sir Isaac Newton?
He did kind of figure out inertia before Isaac Newton, I think.
Yeah, it's very confusing which one did what and how the, who should get credit for different things. But so Hobbes is aware of this too, and so he figures that unless something stops the movement, it's going to keep going. Aristotle thought the movement stops as soon as it got where it wanted to be, which is like really dumb. Aristotle came up with a lot of dumb stuff that people believed for like over 2,000 years, right? So that's why one of the things we could say about the modern period is they're revolting against Aristotelian science. Right? Galileo is proving, oh, Aristotle's wrong about things falling, motion. What makes something stop? It was thought that unless God kept moving it, it would stop. But now we have, yes, momentum, inertia, And so Hobbes is saying, well, so these movements keep going in the brain. Right? So they're motion. So when you talk to one another, these are motions in the air, and they enter into my head, and even while I'm sleeping, they keep bouncing around. So the dreams, if you read the section on dreams in the Leviathan, that's because those motions are still bouncing around while we're sleeping. They don't stop. They keep bouncing around. And they cause reactions. So for Hobbes, all this thinking that's going on are motions in my head that are physical. And so if I'm thinking, cogito, right, I have motions in my physical head, which means that I must have a physical body. So
isn't that what Descartes said too? So they both agreed on that?
Well, I don't think Descartes actually, you know, it's pretty interesting. I think Descartes officially believes in a mind-body dualism, right? So we have a mind and we have a body. So it's a dualism. You have the two things. Whereas for Hobbes, he's a monist, or a physicalist, or everything is like Aristotle, it's physical. So he doesn't disagree with Aristotle on that, that everything has to have substance. Although he does say that, you know, that I'm pretty sure it's Hobbes, that you can't actually say this thing is substance. Like Descartes says, I'm thinking, therefore I'm a thinking thing. Hobbes has a beautiful line where he says, well, I'm walking, therefore I'm a walk. No, that's just dumb. You know, it depends. You know, so you have to have a physical object that's got the characteristic that you're describing.
So Hobbes is kind of more like into realism and like what's like tangible and observable, and he's more like a, like mechanics based as far as like that sort of thing goes.
Yes, yes. So Hobbes, and this results in the British being this way. So this is the difference between the British empiricists, which officially gets started with Locke, but I don't know why that happens, because Locke is basically taking it all from Hobbes. So it should, I know exactly why the British empiricist problem begins with Locke. That's because he's the first one to realize that that means I'm not actually seeing anything. I'm experiencing the way my senses are reacting to the thing, but I'm not seeing the thing. Hobbes doesn't say that. For Hobbes, I'm experiencing the things, right? But that's still empiricist. There's a Roman philosopher named Sextus Empiricus. It has to be a pseudonym because it means sixth sense. really, Sextus Empiricus. It's like his philosophical name. It's not my fault. I don't know if he saw dead people. Your eyebrows told me that you didn't catch the movie reference, The Sixth Sense.
Oh, I haven't seen that.
You haven't seen that. Okay, so.
Spoiler alert.
Oh yeah, I'm sorry.
To be fair, I
ruined that movie
long enough to.
I know the quote from it that I see dead people. I know that part. That's the only thing I know about the movie.
Didn't you know the movie?
You can still. So my question, I don't really know the answer to it, but when you think about contemporary neuroscience, you know, there are actually two sides to that. Didn't I mention Stuart Hameroff and Roger Penrose?
They're the ones that were into the
Or theory, which I don't remember when it it means
work or
theory of the mind.
About memories in quantum.
Right. Levels. That's the quantum theory.
Yeah.
So if the work or theory is correct, that strikes me that Descartes might be closer to a contemporary neuroscientist. If, on the other hand, people like Steven Pinker and others that believe that it's all physical motions in the head, in this case electrical, biochemically electrical, right? Then that might be more like Hobbes. So you could go either way on that. Hopefully there's no right or wrong answer on that. You can argue either way. Remember, I just give everybody A's for 300 plus words. So that you can be relaxed on that. You don't have to sweat bullets. Sweat bullets? No. It's not in it. We don't even use that metaphor anymore, right?
It used to be
a saying. Yeah. So that's a good question. That's a thought-provoking question for me. So that's like, I wonder which of them would have been closer to a neuroscientist. They're clearly being influenced by Galileo, but in different ways. So when we think of the British as British empiricists, they're following along with Hobbes and Francis Bacon, who I should have mentioned somewhat, because Hobbes was Francis Bacon's secretary for a while. There's lots of things you could talk about Francis Bacon. He died because he liked chicken.
That's really sad.
He was trying to freeze it. He got an idea that ice would preserve meat. So he went to a farm at a late evening on a snowy evening and bought a chicken that the housewife plucked and gave him. This dead chicken. And he went outside in the snow and stuffed it with snow and got pneumonia and died. So refrigeration wasn't invented yet. All that happened was it killed.
Killed the inventor.
Killed the inventor before it happened. So that's kind of interesting. My favorite aspect of Francis Bacon, and it is spelled just like Bacon, yes, and he would be really a contemporary of Galileo. We put him up here. Francis Bacon, when was he born and died? Anybody? I'd be using my own machine if
1561. Died
1626. 1626, due to a chicken. Right? Yeah. So he didn't
get 65.
So he was 65. Your math skills are excellent.
The Wikipedia.
Oh.
they're not that good.
So the neatest thing is Bacon. There's a group of people that are called Baconites that believe that Shakespeare wasn't really the author of Shakespeare's works, but that Shakespeare was the fake author, and Bacon was really the one, because he was too noble and important to be writing that kind of trash, right? So that's kind of interesting. And Shakespeare didn't have that kind of education. Look, his wife did. His wife can read.
I think some people also think that his wife was actually right in the place.
There's a great book called Shakespeare's Wife, Anne Hathaway.
I know.
Anne Hathaway.
Yeah, her name's Anne Hathaway.
Yeah, and the cover. What's her name? Gere, the author. the author of Shakespeare's Wife is a feminist. But the picture shows the back of a woman in an older kind of dress, and she's holding a book, as I recall, indicating she's like, she doesn't want people to know. You're not supposed to read if you're a woman.
He was born he was baptized in 1564, so if he was Francis Bacon, then it all stands up.
Well, I'm not saying that they were identical people. There was really a William Shakespeare.
But that, like, somebody else was writing the plays, and then Shakespeare was just... Because he was like a sheep shearer in some random town.
Yeah, he was like an actor.
Oh, okay.
He did act in the plays. You know, they were the king's men, and they acted in the Globe and all that sort of thing. So this, it's just interesting. And Bacon really impacted the writing style, especially his essay. So Ben Jonson, who was like a critic, I think I spelled his name right, J-O-N-S-O-N, Ben Jonson, who I believe created the first dictionary, as far as I know, or at least the first English dictionary. He was also a critic. And in talking about writing, was the one who made Shakespeare famous. And I think had the big galley printed of Shakespeare's works. But he also highly talks about Bacon. But Hobbes was Bacon's secretary for a while, and in fact did translations for Bacon. So that's odd, because when Ben Jonson talks about Bacon's writing style, he says he picked it up by basically taking classics like Cicero and Seneca and others and using their style, but being much more efficient. That is much more to the point in English. But if he's that good at translating from Latin, you would think that he would be able to do his own translations, and yet Hobbes, then as secretary, was doing some of his translations. Maybe, sure, why not? But so, did you have another, did I answer that question pretty well? That, you know, so the thing that interesting about Hobbes, hello, you can come in. The thing that's interesting about Hobbes is free will. Because when you're Descartes, you can have free will. That's kind of a magical, you know, you're not a physical being. Your mind is non-physical. Your body is physical. And this dualism, you know, has this interaction between the two, which is like the big problem for Descartes. There's a book titled Descartes' Error by Antonio Damasio, who's a contemporary neuroscientist, one of the main ones. And that was his first major book on the subject, was Descartes' Error. And he had Searching for Spinoza, The Feeling of What Happens, which was, I thought, the best one, right? And he's got other ones now, and I haven't kept up with them, sorry. But that's kind of interesting. But he's a neuroscientist that points out that Descartes' error is that, obviously, our brain is physical. So he's on that side.
Yeah, well, that makes sense, because... I don't know. It doesn't seem like Descartes has like a lot in common with like modern day Nero stuff? Because
well,
you're saying that your mind is not physical, and like we know for sure that it is. So like, how is that even like up for debate? Really, how is like Descartes more modern?
You think of like the quadriplegic trying to drive a stick shift car. And that's before we have like brain chips that, you know, you could manipulate things, you know. Back when I first thought of that, you know, you only could drive by actually stepping on the pedals and turning the wheel and stuff. There's no automatic cars. Like at this point I would gladly play the Audi advertisement where the T-Rex drives the assisted driving car. If you've ever seen the commercial, it's hilarious. Put it right down, T-Rex, Audi, assisted driving commercial. It's absolutely beautifully done and hilarious. You'll laugh for sure. But here's my thinking on this. Now, I don't know where you could find support for this. And by the way, if you take the graduate record exam and the question is, Descartes was a mind-body dualist, the answer is yes, or you get it wrong. But I suspect that he was just as much influenced by Galileo as Hobbes and thought that the body was a complete mechanical thing, including the mind, but he didn't want to get burned at the stake. So he left a spot in his writings for the equivalent of the soul, called it the mind, and in fact, in the text, if you saw it, there's or look up Descartes' illustration of the pineal gland. You know, he actually drew that in his text. It was this little guy, which we refer to as the homunculus. Kind of like this little guy sitting in your head, driving your body. So that's your mind, right? And you think, well, wait a minute. This non-material soul or mind cannot interact with the physical body because there's no similar. That's the you know, how does your soul interact with your body, right? You know, that's forever been an issue with the church. I mean, Augustine, all the theologians tried to figure out how does the soul receive the, because the body sees, hears, tastes, touch, etc. So how does that feed into the soul? And then the soul makes decisions and interacts with the body. So Descartes has that same problem, except it's now referred to as a mind-body problem. And Damasio calls it Descartes' error, but my thinking is that Descartes left that in his works. But when you look for what the mind does, it doesn't have any job. The body does everything because of the motions and everything else, but he always leaves this idea of the mind sitting there in the pineal gland interacting with the body, right? So, for sure, Descartes is dissecting bodies too. In fact, if you look up the picture of the anatomy lesson by Dr. Tulip's anatomy lesson, you probably would recognize it. It's like kind of it's a Rembrandt. So you've got this darkish background as Rembrandt would do. And you've got all these individuals in their kind of pietist suits. They're Dutch, right? All looking at the one guy in the center who's hovering with like a scalpel pointing at the wrist of a dead body on the table, right? So the anatomy lesson of Dr. Tulip. And yes, Dr. Tulip is the one that invented tulips. That's an easy name to remember, Tulip. Dr. Tulip, liked tulips and started the Dutch tulip thing. It's kind of neat, right? That's where, you know, they sell rows and rows of tulips and bulbs and stuff. And Tulip, Dr. Tulip, that's the name. But here he is doing a dissection in, you know, Amsterdam, and we know that Descartes was there. He wasn't one of the ones in the painting, but he was in the audience. And by the way, it's like a lunch thing. So while they're watching, yes. Yeah, it was, you know, a dinner show kind of thing. So they're sitting there eating while they're watching the doctor dissecting the body. And we know where the body came from. The body was a criminal that had been hung that day. And Dr. Tulip arranged to have it, he paid for the body. So that the guy, the hangman, as soon as he cut him down, put him in the wagon, and brought him to Dr. Tulip's office for the show. He was hung because he had, like, kind of like the three strikes law in California. He had stolen too many times. And in fact, Rembrandt had to fake the one arm because his one arm was already cut off from a previous crime. So there's all kinds of stuff we know about this guy and the, it's just cool, all this stuff. But we know that Descartes was there. So he's not alone in being interested in, but still illegal. So what they're doing is paying people to dig up bodies after they've been officially buried or something and then delivered. And so he's dissecting them in his living room, basically. And famously, Descartes moved every 3 months. And I know why. Because they didn't have, they couldn't clean. They didn't have antiseptic cleaning stuff.
So
right?
They didn't get sick more often.
People did get sick. And, how did he not get sick? But in that picture that he drew, he draws the pineal gland, which means he's found that. Mm-hmm. Right? Named it that. And he thought that that was the site where the soul interacted, the mind interacted with the body. So somehow this spiritual thing is interacting with the physical thing. So Descartes' error. So it really does look like he's made this commitment to a spiritual kind of interaction. But on the other hand, he talks about how the body does things, everything seems to be just like Hobbes with the idea of motions. Even the motions going into the brain and continuing around, but then the mind makes a decision. Is he just throwing that in there in order to keep the church from thinking that he's denying the existence of the soul? Hobbes left England at least four times. Three times taking a young person as on a tour, the one time visiting Galileo. But he also spent over 10 years. I think it was the 1560s, living in Paris with Father Marcin was like the hub there, another interested scientist. Speaking of which, Bacon is the one that inspired the Royal Society, his book. So that's something else that we learned, we know. So the Royal Society in London wasn't started by him, but it was inspired by his books on the new learning and stuff. Hobbes, for 10 years, is there. That's when he was also tutoring Charles II. But he's there because he's afraid for his life in England. You could come in.
Oh.
We're still finishing up, but I mean, it's philosophy, so I feel like. So when we think about the interaction between Hobbes and Descartes. Did they ever meet? I don't know. But obviously they're interacting because Hobbes is one of the ones invited to respond to Descartes' meditations and sends two responses. So it's back and forth. They get upset with one another. They're not happy because they eventually get to the point where they're saying to one another, I don't see your point. I'm not going to argue it any further. You know, it's kind of like they've had it with one another. So that's kind of interesting how that happens. They're fighting over the body and stuff. This is one big happy family. So what else? What other questions do you have?
About Hobbes?
Well, I'm trying to blend all these folks together because they are. I mean, you can't ignore the fact that they're all interacting with one another.
So what is Hobbes' theory of knowledge?
So it's all motions. So these motions enter into our body from sensory input.
Mm-hmm.
He does not say that the mind is a blank slate. But John Locke, who is the next generation British philosopher, clearly influenced by Hobbes, is going to say that. But you can see that that's basically already there. If all of what I have in my brain comes from these motions which enter into my body through my senses, through different... And it's neat how he tries to figure that out. As you're reading the Leviathan, it's kind of amazing how he figures that all out. And so my knowledge is a result of all these motions entering into the brain. And language is an important part of that because we construct language, which are motions. We do hear the sounds or see the text, right? And so there are motions coming into our head. And so his theory of knowledge is basically a very physical set of emotions that are going on in the brain. And our goal in life for Hobbes is pleasure and avoidance of pain. So this is like as British as it gets. Right? You know, it eventually will become the utilitarianism with Jeremy Bentham, but Hobbes says it, Locke says it, you know, so this is like at least Hobbes is involved. Maybe you could go to Francis Bacon and earlier. You know, how deep do you want to dig, right, into their history to figure out where all this comes from? But clearly, Hobbes is would have loved Locke's idea of the tabula rasa. You know, the blank slate. You know, that it's not like we've got all this knowledge at birth. Whereas the Europeans are rationalists, and Descartes is like the beginning one. So if I were to like draw kind of a set of relationships with the following set of philosophers, we could put Hobbes on one side. If I had colors, I could draw him red, because that's a good color for London. Although, this is my London tie. But in Descartes, we could draw blue. And then between the two of them, very neatly we get Spinoza.
Is that your London tie because you got it in London, or just because?
I don't know where my dad gave it. He died.
It's right on the
and
tie.
I stole it from the closet. In fact, I stole all the ties.
Good story.
But it says London on it. See? It
says they're
London.
Also red on the back, though. London tie.
But it does say London. 400.
Mm-hmm.
But made in USA.
Oh.
I feel like it's the last British then. It says London.
Well, I mean, you know, Make America Great Again, you look at the label, it's made in China.
Yeah, it's
True.
Right? Was it really? I mean, I believe so.
I never got one of those.
Yeah, I didn't either. So,
good luck there, right?
And then, Leibniz, over there. And then, over here, we end up with, I don't know how many E's are in Berkeley.
Berkeley?
That's the, like,
it's the same as the university.
That's the utilitarianism guy, right?
I wouldn't, they call him a British idealist.
Okay.
But he is an empiricist.
Is he the one who preserved his head?
No, that's Jeremy Bentham.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Yeah.
That's his whole body. The head is sitting on the floor.
Yeah.
The body is preserved with a wax head.
Okay.
And yes, if you're there, you should get a selfie with Jeremy Bentham. Kind of fun. Oh, and we need a quiz question. So what would be a good quiz question? Why is Hobbes buried in Alt Hucknall? Why did they bury him there?
Descartes or Hobbes?
Hobbes. Good question. I don't, you know, where did they bury Descartes? I would think they sent his body eventually back. Was he buried in Stockholm?
I don't know.
But Hobbes is buried in Alt Hucknall. I've seen a picture of the stone. It's in that church. I think it's St. Mary's in Alt Hucknall. But how the heck did that happen?